Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, and welcome back to our Tafseer class. We are doing the kitab known as Al-Jami'u li-Ahkam al-Qur'an, better known as Tafseer al-Qurtubi. We are doing the Tafseer of Surah At-Takweer, and tonight, inshallah ta'ala, we are starting from ayah number 12. So let us begin. Bismillahi walhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. So he says, qawlu ta'ala, wa idha al-jahimu su'irat, أي أوقدت فضمرت للكفار وزيد في إحمائها يقال سعرت النار وأسعرتها وقراءة العامة بالتخفيف من السعير وقرأ نافع وابن ذكوان ورويس بالتشديد لأنها أوقدت مرة بعد مرة قال قتادة سعرها غضب الله وخطايا بني آدم. So he says the ayah, وَإِذَا الْجَحِيمُ سُعِرَتْ, when Jahannam, when the fire of Jahannam will be set ablaze. So he says, أُوْقِرَتْ, it will be stoked. فَضْمَرَتْ, so it will increase the, in its heat for the kuffar. So he explains, سَعَرْتُ النَّارَ وَأَسَعَرْتُهَا, shows that that's how you use the word. He says, amongst the Qurra, they read it as, وَإِذَا الْجَحِيمُ سُعِرَتْ, سُعِرَتْ, not سُعِرَتْ, without the tashdeed, su'irat is one qira'ah and su'irat is the other qira'ah. So it says Imam Nafi, Imam Ibn Dakwan, and Imam Ruiz, they read it with the tashdeed su'irat. Because what's the difference between su'irat and su'irat? Su'irat means that it will be stoked and stoked and stoked. Because every time you stoke a fire, it gets stronger and stronger and stronger. So it means that when Jahannam is stoked, we already know the heat of Jahannam, but it will be stoked and stoked and stoked to increase the heat and the fire of Jahannam. He goes further. He says, وَفِي التِّرْمِذِي عَنَ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ عَنِ النَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمَ قَالَ أُوْقِدَ عَلَى النَّارِ أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ حَتَّى أَحْمَرَّتْ ثُمَّ أُوْقِدَ عَلَيْهَا أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ حَتَّى بِيَضَّتْ ثُمَّ أُوْقِدَ عَلَيْهَا أَلْفَ سَنَةٍ حَتَّى سَوَدَّتْ فَهِيَ سَوْدَاءُ مُظْلِمَةٌ وَرُوِيَ مَوْقُوفًا. He says in a hadith, that Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu reports that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said that Jahannam, the fire of Jahannam was stoked for 1,000 years until it became red. Then it was stoked for another 1,000 years until the fire became white. Then it was stoked for another 1,000 years until it became black. فَهِيَ سَوْدَاءُ مُظْلِمَةٌ. So the fire of Jahannam is a fire which is black and dark. You know, in this world, we don't exactly have a fire of this type. If you take the strongest fire that is on earth, that is, you know, not even a pinprick in comparison to what the fire of Jahannam is. You know, when you talk a fire that reaches white hot, so boiling it is. And that is not the white that is being referred to over here that was stoked until it reached that level. The fire that we have on earth doesn't go beyond the red stage. So, you know, a person may change the colors, we can have green fire and all things of the sort, but it doesn't change the actual essence of the heat itself, because this world can't handle that sort of fire. You know how it is. If you were to bring certain things near heat, it just melts and disappears. So that is what the fire of Jahannam is like, that if you were to come such a distance from it, if you were able to melt, you would have melted. That's how the heat of Jahannam is. So when Jahannam is said to be black and dark, it's dark because there are no lights in Jahannam. Now you may be thinking, you know, but fire, why would Jahannam be dark when fire itself is bright? And this hadith put things into perspective, that the reason why it is dark is because the fire itself is black, so it does not light things up the way a red or a white fire would. So the black fire doesn't give light, it burns, a burn that this world has never seen the likes of. This narration is also reported in a mawqu form, meaning as the words of Hazrat Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. We move on now. He says, وَإِذَا الْجَنَّةُ أُزْلِفَتْ. That's all he dealt with that previous ayah. So he moves on to the next one. وَإِذَا الْجَنَّةُ أُزْلِفَتْ. In the next ayah, Allah says, when Jannah is brought near. He says, أَيْدَنَتْ وَقَرَّبَتْ مِنَ الْمُتَّقِينَ. قَالَ الْحَسَنِ إِنَّهُمْ يُقَرَّبُونَ مِنْهَا لَا أَنَّهَا تَزُولُ عَن مَوْضَعِهَا. وَكَانَ عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنُ بْنُ زَيْدٍ يَقُولُ زُيِّنَتْ. So short tafsir for this ayah, he says that, what's the meaning of when Jannah will be brought near? He means it will come close to the believers, because that's where the believers will be going. But Imam Hassan, he adds on a point of a note here. He says that the Muslims will be brought close to Jannah, not that Jannah will move from its place. Contrary to the case of Jahannam, because Jahannam has its place, but the Malaika will bring Jahannam, you know, with chains. And Jahannam will break loose from the Malaika out of anger for the Kuffar. So there's a distinction where Jahannam does have its place, but Jahannam is a living, breathing, speaking, seeing creature, as I always mention. So Jahannam will move away and Jahannam will come close for the Kuffar, literally moving from its place. But that's not the case with Jannah. Jannah is there. Jannah doesn't switch and move from place A to place B. It's massive and it is what it is. So the doors of Jannah and everything is over there. And the mu'minin will now be brought and told to enter Jannah. So the closer you are to Jannah, the closer you are to entering it. So Muslims will be moved towards Jannah rather than Jannah coming towards them. He says Imam Abdurrahman ibn Zayd used to read or at least interpret Uzlifat as Zuyinat. So when Jannah is beautified is how he would understand. That's one of the meanings of Uzlifat. He says, وَالزُّلْفَى فِي كَلَامِ الْعَرَبِ عَلَى قُرْبَى قَالَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ وَتَزَلَّفَ فُلَانٌ تَقَرَّبَى. He says, Zulfa, Uzlifa, the same one here in the Arabic language, it means to come close. He says, like Allah Ta'ala says in another surah, in Surah Al-Shu'ara, that وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, and Jannah will be brought close for the believers. Okay, he says, تَزَلَّفَ فُلَان means the person has تَقَرَّبَ فُلَان, that so-and-so came close. So that's two ayat. Let's move on to the next one. He says, قَوْلُهُ تَعَالَى عَلِمَتْ نَفْسٌ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ. The soul then will know what it has prepared, what it has sent forth. In other words, you now know what have you brought with you, what have you left behind. You may have done whatever you did in this world. On this day, when all of this is taking place, now you will know what is reality and what deeds you had brought with you that is of goodness that will help you on this day. يعني ما عملت من خير وشر وهذا جواب إذا الشمس كورت وما بعدها قال عمر رضي الله عنه لهذا أجري الحديث وروي عن أبي عن ابن عباس وعمر رضي الله عنهما أنهما قرأها فلما بلغ علمت نفس ما أحضرت قال لهذا أجريت القصة. فالمعنى على هذا إذا الشمس كورت وكانت هذه الأشياء علمت نفس ما أحضرت من عملها. Okay, so starting from the beginning, you say علمت نفس ما أحضرت. On that day, a person will know what he has brought with. So whatever good or bad you had done in this world, on that day you will know it. He says that this is an answer. It's like the conclusion of what happens. It follows the first 13 ayat, so to speak, of Surah At-Takweer are all leading up to this point. So, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ انْكَدَرَتْ وَإِذَا etc. etc. When the sun will be rolled up and the stars fall down from its places, and all of these take place on that day, you will know. So all those 13 ayat that preceded this ayah, عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ, it was all leading you up to this point. That why are all of these things taking place? It's taking place so that on that day, you will now know what you have brought forth. Okay, so Hadhrat Umar radiallahu anhu, he would read this, إِذَا شَمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, and then he would say, for this, because of all of these things, that's why the story goes in this way. These 13 things then come عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ for this reason, like I just explained now. He says he's also reported from Hadhrat Abdullah ibn Abbas and Hadhrat Umar radiallahu anhuma that they would read the surah until they reach عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ, and then they would say لِهَذَا أُجْرِيَتِ الْقِصَّةِ for this. All 13 ayat prior to this comes for the, and it culminates in this one ayah عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ. So he says the meaning thus according to this is either shamsu kuwirat, you know, when the sun falls down from its places, and the when its sun is rolled up and the stars fall down from its places, and seas are turned to fire, and the fire of Jahannam is set ablaze, and all of these things. On that day, when all of these things are taking place, then a person will know what he has brought forth of his deeds. وفي الصحيحين عن علي بن حاتم رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما منكم من أحد إلا وسيكلمه الله ما بينه وبينه ترجمان فينظر أيمن منه فلا يرى إلا شيئا قدمه وينظر أشأم منه فلا يرى إلا شيئا قدمه وينظر أمامه فتستقبله النار فمن استطاع منكم أن يتقي النار ولو بشق تمرة فليفعل. Okay, so in the Sahihain, Hadrat Ali ibn Hatim radiyallahu anhu narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that there is none of you but that Allah will speak to him with no tarjuman. You know, there's no going to be no middleman. There'll be no interpreter. It's not like Allah is going to speak to some malaika, some malak, and that malak must now come and speak to you. No, Allah will speak directly to you. Except, of course, to kuffar. Kuffar won't have the favor of being able to speak to Allah, but this is for the believers. So on that day of Qiyamah, Allah will speak directly to you without any interpreter, without any in-between. So a person will look to his right, and he will see nothing except those things which he had brought forth. And he will look to his side, and he won't see anything but that which he had brought forth. And he will look in front of him. فَتَقْبِلُهُ النَّارِ. You know, you look, you're standing in front of Allah. Jahannam is here. Here's your good and your bad deeds. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is telling you, whoever of you is capable to protect himself against the fire, even if it be with a piece of a date, then let him do so. What does this mean? It means that do whatever good deed you can do. Anything and everything will be on that scale. When you look there to the side on that day of Qiyamah, that good deed that you did that was minuscule and unimportant in your eyes in this world, on that day it will be there and it will be more beloved to you than anything in this entire world. So, you know, even if you have a piece of a date that you give in sadaqah, Allah accepts all good that you do. So it doesn't matter that it's a piece of date. It doesn't matter that it's not a whole day. It can be a sliver. It's to show that no matter how minuscule and unimportant and small a deed it is, that you may think it's insignificant, but in the sight of Allah, it's not insignificant. So if you happen to have a piece of date, it doesn't mean go and look around for a piece of date now. It means if you own nothing except a piece of date and you're able to give that in sadaqah, then do so. In our terms, it would be, you know, if you've got nothing and you've got a 10 cent or a 5 cent that you can give in sadaqah, then give even that. That's what it means. It's showing to give something which is like absolutely inconsequential, so minuscule it is in the eyes of people. But even something so small will benefit you on that day. So every good deed that you do will be a barrier and a protection between you and Jahannam. So the more good deeds you have, the further away from Jahannam you will be. The less good deeds you have, the closer to Jahannam you will be. Okay, moving on. He says, وَقَالَ الْحَسَنُ إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ قَسَمٌ وَقَعَ عَلَىٰ قَوْلِهِ عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ كَمَا يُقَالُ إِذَا نَفَرَ زَيْدٌ نَفَرَ عَمْرٌ وَالْقَوْلُ الْأَوَّلُ أَصَحُ. So Imam Hassan, he says that إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ, the beginning ayah of the surah, it is actually an oath that Allah is taking. And the culmination of the oath takes effect on عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ. He says, like how it is said, you know, if Zayd runs, Amr will run. So when this has been attained, this will take place. So when all of these things take place, عَلِمَتْ نَفْسُ مَا أَحْضَرَتْ. But he say, the Imam Qurtubi rahimahullah says, the first view that we mentioned above, that is the more authentic, that all of these things were, Allah is telling you, when all these 13 things basically are taking place, these 13 ayat, then a person will come to know what he has brought forth. That is the culmination of it. It's not exactly a promise, but it is information that Allah is giving us. وقال ابن زيد عن ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما في قوله تعالى إذا الشمس كورت إلى قوله وإذا الجنة أزلفت 12 خصلة ستة في الدنيا وستة في الآخرة وقد بينا الستة الأولى بقول أبي بن كعب رضي الله عنه. So Imam Ibn Zayd narrates from Hadith Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhu with regards to the ayah إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ until وَإِذَا الْجَنَّةُ أُزْلِفَتْ. Those are the 13 ayahs, so to speak. So he says there are 12 things mentioned in there. Six of them in this world and six of them in the year after. And, you know, we explained the six things in this world in the statement of Hadrat Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu previously. You know, if you're talking about the six, if you went back, you know, I've shifted back to this point here, which is under the tafsir of the sixth ayah. Okay, وَإِذَا الْوَحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. Yeah, under وَإِذَا الْوَحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ. Under that ayah, we did the statement of Hadrat Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu anhu, six things before the day of Qiyamah. When the people are in their marketplace and the sun, light of the sun disappears, etc., etc., all of those sort of things. That was the six things that take place in this world. The sun's light which disappear, the stars which falls down from its place, and so on and so forth. Those are the six things that are being referred to over here. So if we were to look at it in this sense, to understand things, what is actually being meant. So, إِذَا الشَّمْسُ كُوِّرَتْ وَإِذَا النُّجُومُ انْكَدَرَتْ وَإِذَا الْجِبَالُ سُيِّرَتْ وَإِذَا الْعِشَارُ عُطِّلَتْ وَإِذَا الْوُحُوشُ حُشِرَتْ وَإِذَا الْبِحَارُ سُجِّرَتْ. Those are the six things that take place in the world. وَإِذَا النُّفُوسُ زُوِّجَتْ is now when you have been brought back to life. وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ when the questioning is taking place. Obviously, is referring to the same thing. So you may have heard 13 ayat, but only 12 things. The reason is because the وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ بِأَيِّ ذَنْبٍ قُتِلَتْ is one thing. Two ayat referring to one issue. So that's the second. وَإِذَا الصُّحُفُ نُشِرَتْ when the pages are spread out. وَإِذَا السَّمَاءُ كُشِطَتْ and the sky is rubbed away. وَإِذَا الْجَحِيمُ سُعِرَتْ and the fire is set, the fire of Jahannam is set ablaze, وَإِذَا الْجَنَّةُ أُزْلِفَتْ and Jannah is brought near. So those are the six things. In other words, putting in this context over here, six signs, or at least six things associated with the destruction of the world, with the sun being rolled up and all of those things, are things that will take place while people are alive. And the next six things will take place when after people have died and spent their time in Barzakh and the world has been destroyed, and now it is the day of Qiyamah. That's when the next six things take place. That's basically what is being said. Okay. We've done a shorter class than usual because I came a lot late tonight, but we did the portion of this tafsir over here. The next part will deal with few more ayat in one go. So we'll stop on this point here for tonight, inshallah, since we've already actually passed the time of when the class was supposed to end. And we'll continue again next week, inshallah, with our next tafsir class. But until then, we end on this point here. Until next time, we end and we say, وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ wa baraka عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَبِحَمْدِهِ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ نَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَنَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ وَالسَّلَامُ عَلَيْكُمْ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ.